from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 and 14. As God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. We're going to sing number 422, I Love You With The Love Of The Lord. It's on your screens at home, number 422, I Love You With The Love Of The Lord.
Good morning and welcome to worship today. Welcome to the month of May. This is the day, the month that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for your faithfulness to tune in and to participate together with your friends and fellow believers in worship. And we know and we trust and we rejoice that from wherever we are in our individual locations today, God, through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, unites us again in that spirit of worship. We have come to give Him thanks and gratitude because He is great and He is greatly to be praised, and His love and His faithfulness, they abound and they endure forever. He has given us good news. He has changed our life with that good news. We are His people, and in His name and with gratitude, we come together now to worship Him. Will you join me now in prayer? God, we pray now for your help to worship you, with all that you have given us, Lord, the passion within us, the gratitude welling up within us, Lord. In your goodness, God, you have provided for us a way to know you again and to be a part of your kingdom, Lord, after we have fallen away from it, God. You have given us grace immeasurable. And even now, in this moment of global crisis, you continue to meet us as the faithful one. And you've provided a way for us to stay connected, Lord, in our worship, God, and we thank you for that. So please, God, help us now to lift up our hearts and our voices to you. Help us, God, to praise you because you are worthy of our praise forever upon forever. This is a worship service really taking place as part of a constant, never-ending stream of worship that will go on till the kingdom comes and beyond into eternity. Thank you for your love for us, love that would send your Son into this world to give His life for us and give us a new spirit that would change us from the inside out. God, thank you. We stand in light of your abundant love and your grace today, God. It overflows for us. And now help us, Lord, to worship you out of genuine gratitude for that. You are good. We thank you. We pray all this in your name, Father, Son, and Spirit, one God, now and forever. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Would you take a moment now, if you haven't already, and if the keyboard is right there in front of you, I would invite you to type in some greetings for your friends and fellow believers to let them know that you welcome them to worship also this morning. So let's have a moment of greeting as we continue with our worship.
Next hymn is on your screen, number 448, I'll Tell the World That I'm a Christian. We'll sing both verses, number 448, I'll Tell the World That I'm a Christian. Everybody is doing well this morning. I just wanted to share an announcement about our senior recognition. As many of you know, today was going to be the day in which we originally planned on doing our senior recognition. But obviously that is not going to happen today because of our present circumstances. But we will reassure you that we are praying for you seniors. We are praying for you families. And we are praying for the next transition that is going to be happening in your lives. And with that being said, I'd like today to say congratulations to Emma Evans, Alyssa Jackson, LJ Pace, Evan Ratcliffe, and Lexi Sharp. Thank you. We'll sing hymn number 372, Our God Reigns. It's on your screens at home. We'll sing all three verses of Our God Reigns.
Announcing peace.
At this time, we're going to have an offertory prayer. We pause and we give thanks to God for His goodness in His provision to us. And as a way of responding to that, we give a portion of what He's given us back to Him for His kingdom's use, a tithe, 10%, and any other offering that He might lay on our hearts. For a few weeks now, we've been unable to take up our gifts and contributions in the most conventional way, passing the offering plate. But if I may take a moment and commend you for your flexibility and your way of adapting to the circumstances. Many of you, if you've already received your version of the newsletter for May, you've seen some of the early financial figures for the month of April, and then Edie actually gave me an update a couple days later for the end of the month, all of which is to say that the month of April, circumstances notwithstanding, the month of April was our best month for giving of the year so far. And for that, I say thank you to your determination to continue showing the first things that are important to you, which is to express your gratitude to God by being consistent and giving of your gifts. So thank you very much. And together we are getting through this extraordinary time. And this is one of the ways that we can see that we are getting through that. We give thanks to God for inspiring us to be dedicated and cheerful givers. You can continue to give with the dropping off in the drop box here at the church or in person at the office, the website, firstbaptistrockmart.org, and the button that says online giving. And of course, you can mail it in to the church as well. But anyway, thank you for your dedication in that respect, and we give thanks to God for all He's given us. And now, if you'll join me, I'm going to pray, and we're going to dedicate these gifts to God. Thank you, God. Thank you for helping us to be good and cheerful and faithful givers. Thank you, God, for inspiring the response, Lord, that our church has given during the month of April. Thank you, God, for the gifts that are given that enable us as a church to be your hands and feet in the world, Lord, to take care of the campus that we have and everything that goes with it, Lord, to fund the ministries and the missionaries and the ministers, God, and and the programs, Lord, that are ongoing, God. Thank you, Lord, for meeting us at the point of our needs individually and as a family and as a church, God. And the gifts that are given at various times, they are all given in gratitude to you, Lord, with the recognition that everything that we have comes from you. And so we are willing to give and glad to give because there's a fount of joy within us that overflows. So thank you, God, for your love for us, your lavish love, God. It amazes us day after day, and really, God, it inspires us, God, and keeps us going. So we thank you, and we love you, and we profess our continual need for you. You are Father, Son, and Spirit. We pray this in your name. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you.
join us for our doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by
presence, Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Jarrett. If you have a Bible, would you take a Bible now? And I invite you to turn in your Bible to the book of Acts, chapter 17. Acts chapter 17 is one of the passages we're referring to in our message for today. Acts chapter 17, verses 10 through 12. And when you're there, when you're at that place in Scripture, follow along with me as I read it aloud. And together, let's get centered and locked in on the Word of God. Acts 17, 10 through 12. The brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they went into the Jewish synagogue. Now these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. Many of them, therefore, believed, with not a few Greek women of high standing, as well as men. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In seminary, I had to take a basic Bible knowledge exam. I'll be honest, when I heard about it, I didn't sweat it. I figured, I know the basics of the Bible. How hard can this be, really? Yeah, it was hard. Really hard. I realized with much humility that I needed to know the Bible better than I did. And that was part of the point of the exam. Our teacher wanted us, if we were truly committed to seminary and committed to pastoring, she wanted us to take the Bible seriously as the basis, the bedrock, the foundation of our ministry, and the foundation of the churches we'd be pastoring. The Bible is our bedrock. Along with the gospel, which we discussed last week, it's part of our foundation as a church. How should we get our knowledge of God but His Word? How should we learn what the church is and what the church exists for if not from sacred Scripture? That's the next sermon in our current sermon series. Healthy church. See, a healthy church, really a church at all, has a certain foundation, a certain organization, a certain function. Right now, today, we're talking about the foundation. For starters, the foundation consists of the gospel, and it also consists of the Bible and biblical theology. A Bible-based knowledge of God. Let's start with a common definition of biblical theology. The first word, biblical, means Bible-based. The second word, theology, means knowledge of God. So put it all together. Biblical theology is a Bible-based knowledge of God, an understanding of God derived from the Scriptures. The Bible tells us about God. Okay, like an encyclopedia? No, not like an encyclopedia. Like a story. The Bible tells us about God, and it does so in the form of a story. There's an obvious beginning. There's an obvious conclusion, and in between, there is a kind of drama that unfolds. This is how we are supposed to learn about God. We read the story. And as we read it, we take note of what God is doing in it. And as we trace God's actions, we learn about God's character. We learn about God's character, for one, by inferring from his actions. And we take note of what other characters in the story say about God, and what the writers themselves say about God. The Bible, as we read it, tells us what God is doing. And we learn, either by reading it explicitly or reading into his actions, we learn about God's character. This is the basis of our theology, our knowledge of God. And since it comes from the Bible, it's a biblical theology, a Bible-based knowledge of God. Jesus himself confirms this. Jesus confirms that Scripture is a story and that it tells us about God. Listen to this from Luke's Gospel, chapter 24. It's Resurrection Sunday. The newly risen Jesus is walking with a couple of guys. His traveling companions, ignorant that it's Jesus walking with them, are still sad about Jesus' death. Starting in verse 25 now of Luke chapter 24, he, Jesus, said to them, "How foolish you are. And how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." Look what Jesus does here. Moses and all the prophets. That's an expression for the entire Bible at that time, what we now call the Old Testament. See, Jesus refers to Moses and all the prophets to explain that God planned for him to die and rise again. He points back to the Old Testament to ground and certify these shocking current events. In other words, look back to your Bible, says Jesus, to learn about God and to learn what his plans and purposes are. In Acts chapter 17, Paul visits the city of Berea. He tells the Bereans about Jesus, his story, and his saving significance. In response, Acts chapter 17, verse 11 says that the Bereans, quote, examined the scriptures day and night to see if what Paul said was true. In other words, they opened their Bibles, at that time the Old Testament, and they checked it against what Paul was telling them about what God had now done through Jesus. Like Jesus directed his two traveling companions, the Bereans looked to the Bible to learn about God and to learn about his plans and purposes. Now, the Berean believers were one of the earliest churches. As a church, they were bound together by their belief in God, and together they looked to the Bible as the source of their knowledge about God, and to confirm the new thing that God was doing in their time. In other words, the Berean church possessed a biblical theology, and they practiced a biblical theology. This might help to illustrate what I'm talking about. This here is the autobiography of Billy Graham, the greatest evangelist, the most popular preacher of our time. Just As I Am, that's the title of his autobiography. If you want to know who Billy Graham is, what his story is, what he did, what he values, then this is the definitive book. Billy Graham wrote it himself. Now, we believers have a book that tells us who God is, what his story is, what he did, what he values, what his plans and purposes are, and how our church can participate in those plans and purposes. That book is the Bible. God himself wrote it, so it's trustworthy and true, and it is sufficient for our life and our mission as a church. If we know this book, then we know about God. There's something else I want us to see in these two passages I've just cited. Jesus and the Bereans, they don't merely confirm that the Bible is a good book. They also indicate that it follows a certain course. See, the Bible, as it tells us about God, tells us a particular story about God. Here's a question for all of us Christians. How well do we know the story of Scripture? It is, after all, our story now. We have been changed by the good news found within it. We now live by its moral code. We have been grafted into it in a real way. It's our story now. We believers need a grasp, at least a grasp of biblical theology. This is also true for our church. We need the knowledge of an outline of the story of Scripture. Now, I'll explain why toward the end of the message, but for now, I want us to refresh our memories about the story. Okay? This might be maybe the simplest, most succinct version of the story is this. Okay? It comes in just four parts. Creation, fall, redemption, consummation. Creation, fall, redemption, consummation. Let me say something briefly about each part. Creation. God creates the world, everything there is. And at the climax, he creates human beings. At first, humanity is in good standing with God. They love God. They obey God. Creation. Creation, fall. God's enemy, the devil, in the guise of a talking serpent, tempts humanity to disobey God. They go against his will. Humanity, consequently, becomes rebellious against God as their king. Life, reality, get distorted. Sickness, suffering, death become ugly realities. Creation, fall, redemption. God initiates a plan to rescue his people from rebellion. First, he sets apart an entire people, the nation of Israel. And then God sends his divine son among them. His name at birth is Jesus. Jesus calls people to submit to God again as their king. He dies to pay off humanity's sin debt against God. He rises from the dead and ascends to heaven. The Holy Spirit comes to live inside all who believe that Jesus died to make them right with God. These believers congregate into local churches. and they devote their lives to telling the world about how to return to God as their King. Creation, fall, redemption, consummation. At some future point, God will bring this world as we know it to a close. Jesus will return to gather believers. The dead will rise. Satan will be vanquished. Final judgment will occur. And then, last and best of all, a new and never-ending creation will commence. Creation, fall, redemption, consummation. That right there is a relatively simple synopsis of the story of Scripture. Now, what I'm going to do next, and quickly, is give another version of the outline. And this one's more detailed. And this one comes from a book. The title is Biblical Theology by a couple of guys, Nick Rourke and Robert Klein. Okay? One, the King creates everything. This takes place in the book of Genesis, chapters 1 and 2. Two, the King curses the rebellion. This takes place at the fall in Genesis chapter 3. Three, the King judges the world the first time. This is the great flood involving Noah. Four, the King blesses. God in Genesis promises Abraham a family full of faithful people. Five, the King rescues. God, in the book of Exodus, delivers his chosen people from slavery. Six, the King commands. God gives his people, his chosen people, a religious law for them to live by. Seven, God guides the King. The King guides and gives. God takes his chosen people to live in the promised land. Eight, the King rules. God rules his people through human kings like David and Solomon. Nine, the King casts out. God sends his chosen people from the promised land into exile. Ten, the King promises. God promises that the exiles will return home. And more. 11, the King comes. God sends his Son into the world. Jesus is fully God and fully man. 12, the King suffers and saves. Jesus sheds his blood to pay the penalty for people's sins. 13, the King sends, S-E-N-D-S, sends. Jesus rises from death and tells his followers to tell the world. 14, the King builds. God forms churches. He reigns and rules in the lives of believers. And 15, the King returns. God fully reveals his kingdom and gathers all his people into it. As you can tell, that's a more detailed version of the outline of the story of Scripture. It's a more detailed outline, and if you'll notice who the main subject is of it all. It's the King. See, the story of Scripture is the story of God restoring his kingship over the world. And he does it by sending his Son, Jesus, to remove the rebelliousness from his subjects' hearts. That's the story. I'm guessing that just about all of us have a favorite book and or favorite movie. Maybe it's your favorite because it entertains you, or it enlightens you, or it just moves you deep down in your core. And to show that it's your favorite, you can recite the plot from memory, can't you? And immediately, right? And in the greatest detail. Now, me, I could probably say this about most Star Trek movies, okay? Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, Star Trek V, Final Frontier, Star Trek First Contact, Star Trek Nemesis. If you name it, I can tell you what happens in it, because they're some of my favorite movies. They tell a fun, entertaining, imaginative story. I enjoy them a lot. Now, when it comes to the Bible, what we have here is a good story, but so much more. It's a story about God. And more than that, it's a story that bears upon our lives, bears upon our standing before God, bears upon our very salvation. No other book is like the Bible. We get the greatest fulfillment, the greatest joy from what we find in this book. For as many favorite stories as we might have, this story here is the most meaningful to our lives. This story is for us believers, which means that it's also a story for the assembly of believers, the church. I submit that this is foundational for our church. Along with the gospel, which we talked about just last week, the Bible, which provides us with a knowledge of God through Scripture, forms our foundation. We believers need to know the story of Scripture, what God has done and what that reveals about Him. This is imperative for us as individual believers and as families and as a church. As we continue now, I want to give two reasons why biblical theology is foundational for our church. Okay? The first reason is this: the Bible guides and guards our church's teaching. Think about it like this. What's the basis of our study time in Sunday school? Where do we get the content from? Same question for the Sunday morning message. What's it based on? Where does it come from? It all comes from the Bible. The story of Scripture guides our teaching time. For every one of us who has a kind of teaching position in this church, our teaching must be founded on sacred Scripture. Now, if we want to borrow from someone who's made a good point in a book of theirs, that's okay, so long as their teaching is Bible-based. No other book is trustworthy and true like the Bible, and so we rely on the Bible and we teach from the Bible. The Bible guides our church's teaching. And as it guides our teaching, it also guards our teaching. Guides and guards. Suppose that someone in some Bible study setting, including the teacher, asks a provocative question or makes some controversial point. Well, we can turn to Scripture as our reliable standard for gauging the merit of what they say. This guards us from introducing any false teaching into our Bible study. See, the Bible guards our church. If it's not consistent with what we know of God from His Word, and if it doesn't fit with the story of Scripture, we know that we can dismiss it. On the other hand, if it agrees with Scripture, and if it dovetails with what we know about God from His Word, then we can affirm it as good and truthful. Biblical theology is foundational for our church because it guides and it guards our church's teaching. That's the first reason it's foundational. Here's the second reason. Biblical theology, a knowledge of God given to us by Scripture, shapes, and guides our church's mission. It guides and guards our church's teaching, and it shapes and guides our church's mission. What are we supposed to be doing as a church? Why has God gathered us together in the first place? Well, finding out is as easy as opening and reading His Word. The Bible reveals to us our church's mission. It tells us about God's mission, and it also tells us that as God's people, we're supposed to make God's mission our mission too. God's mission is our church's mission. As the story of Scripture tells us, God's mission is to restore His kingship over the world. And in this way, the Bible shapes our mission too. In some places, actually, the Bible rather straightforwardly tells us that this is our mission. Go therefore and make disciples. Go to people and bring them back into the kingdom. But more than that, the Bible also helps us to know how to carry out the mission. How to carry ourselves, the kind of character we ought to live by. Remember, we learn from Scripture who God is. And that tells us, as God's people, how we should conduct ourselves while we are on mission. Our identity as a church has been written out for us in God's Word. It's rooted in a story of Scripture. The Bible tells us who God is, what God has done, and how we can know Him. We need this story to know who we are. We need this story to know what we must be doing. With the Bible as our basis, our church is grounded in truth and goodness and beauty. We are poised to continue as a force for love and righteousness in our local community and the world beyond. Why? Because we have a sure and steady guide, a guard against error, and a compass to help us see our way forward. If we lash ourselves to the Word of God, we will always be in God's will. God has given us His Word, graciously given us His Word so that we may know Him. And by knowing Him, we know ourselves. And we also know where we're headed. See, a good biblical theology, a good Bible-based knowledge of God, it informs us and assures us that we have a definitive destiny ahead. Because as we read through to the end of the story of Scripture, you know what we're doing? We are reading the outcome of our own story. As a church, we get our bearings from the Bible. The Bible is our inerrant, infallible, incorruptible, indispensable guide. We live and breathe. We proceed and proclaim. We move and minister with a Bible-based knowledge of God guiding us. It is enough. It is sufficient. It is worthy of our reading, worthy of our learning, worthy of our trust, and worthy of our love. Let's pray. Your Word, God, guides us and guards us, shapes us and forms us, molds us and makes us. Thank you for the Bible as an integral part of the foundation of our church. Will you help us to remain ever faithful to your Word? Your Word tells us wonderful things. It also tells us hard things. And because it is your Word, we gladly receive all of it. because all of your word helps to form us into the church we should be. This we pray in your name as we rededicate ourselves to knowing you through your word, Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. Thank you for your attention to God's word with me. This is a moment when we begin to respond to the presence of God with us in worship and also to what we've heard through God's word today. So I would advise that we use this time to begin thinking about where the word is in our lives in terms of its relative importance, its priority, its place. What we need to do differently or to do more consistently to keep doing with the word. That can be part of our response now. But we will respond each and individually according to the Spirit guiding us, the same Spirit who inspired this word. And as we do that, we will also sing a few verses of song. So will you join me now as we begin to respond? If you would stay tuned for just another couple of minutes, it's not like there's a Braves game on that you're going to turn to, right? So if you'll hang in there, I do want to just make a couple of announcements, pass out some more pertinent information as far as the life of our church goes. Actually, at this time, I'm going to invite Jarrett Dooley up to make a couple of announcements regarding his ministries, and then I'll come back up and continue. So come on, Jarrett.
I just wanted to make a few announcements concerning camp and VBS. I know we've all been kind of asking that question, you know, what is going to happen with camp and VBS? Well, as far as camp goes, they had student life had to make the difficult decision to forego our camp this year. And so we are continuing to pray. We're continuing to assess. We're continuing to look forward to the fall, and we definitely value student life's take on our kids' health, and that is the take that you know we're all taking right now with that. So also VBS, we're you know the health is of our kids and our community is a certain priority. And that is a definite priority. And so with that being said, we will not be having VBS, but with also I'd just like to point out that we look forward to having a virtual opportunity that we will present to our kids and to our community. And so if you have information that you'd like to send to me as far as email, that would be great. I would love to have your address. If you want to send that to me so that we can send some information out to you concerning VBS. And so I'd just like to share those things with you at this time, and we look forward to what's ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Jarrett. As someone who spent many years working for student life camps, you know, I can vouch that it was a very difficult decision for them to make as far as canceling youth camp for this year. But I can see, we can all, I believe, see the wisdom behind that. And much of that same wisdom has driven our own decision to cancel Vacation Bible School, at least as we've traditionally experienced it this year. But I do appreciate Jarrett for his innovative thinking as far as coming up with a virtual experience that we will be able to provide for our kids and for our families. Ultimately, you know, it's an assessment of the risks, and right now it's just those are some events that we just cannot in good conscience participate in because of, you know, the crowds involved and other considerations. On that note, let me say this as well. Since we're now in the month of May, people will be, we're looking, wondering, for more signs of normalcy to return. I've written about this in the most recent newsletter article, so I would refer you to that as well. But hopefully, in a nutshell, I would say that we continue as a church to take a wait and see approach. Rather, I should say, assess, wait and assess and see approach as far as when we will have the opportunity to come back and meet again together. Ultimately, as a church, we want to be part of the solution. Ultimately, as a church, we want to be part of the solution and not a continuation of the problem. And so we will continue to deliberate very carefully about when we open the campus back up. And so thank you for your patience and your thoughtfulness about that. It is a very big factor to us what our governments and our leaders have prescribed and encouraged. For instance, I know that our governor has strongly encouraged those of a certain age and stage to continue remaining where they are inside as much as possible for the next few weeks. That's a big factor in our thinking as well. We want to make sure that no one's health is jeopardized as we look forward and to meeting together again as a church in God's good timing. So thank you for your patience, your flexibility with that. I want to just add a word of congratulations to our graduates. I am so sorry that we are unable to hold our traditional graduate recognition service. That's just, I know, one part of this extraordinary, unusual experience that has been yours for the past couple months now. But please believe me when I say that God redeems all things, and God is able to redeem this disappointment for you seniors as you pivot toward the rest of your life. I promise that is so. We do look forward to holding a traditional graduate recognition service at some point when we're meeting back together as a church, possibly in conjunction with high school graduation services when those are rescheduled as well. And if you have a graduate who's a part of our church and we've not heard from you yet as far as their information, a picture and whatnot, please contact Jarrett Dooley with that additional information, because we want them to be recognized. Maybe the last thing I'll mention is just to invite you again to prayer meeting. Tune in for prayer meeting this coming Wednesday night at 6:30 through the Facebook live stream. As always, continue to take all the necessary precautions. Take care of yourself. Take care of others. And sooner rather than later, God's going to get us to the other side of this. We're going to be back in here together in person. But in the meantime, there's much that God can teach us in the current circumstances. So I pray for our attentive hearts to learn that. Thank you for being a part of our worship service. I hope and pray that you continue to know that I love and appreciate you. I thank you for the outpouring of love and appreciation for me. Thank you to Andrew, Jarrett, Rita, and Lavinia for being here today to help facilitate this service. We might have access to this church campus right now, but believe me, it is bracing every time we walk into the sanctuary these past several Sundays and we see that these pews are empty. It's a stark reminder for us every Sunday, and it makes us long for that time when we are back in here together as well. But thank you for hanging in there and for the love and the care you have shown for each other in the meantime. I'm going to pray, and then we'll begin to dismiss our service. God, help us now to go from here with your blessing, to value your word all over again as foundational for our church. And I pray, Lord, that you will help us in these unusual times to continue to be patient, flexible, to continue to be on the lookout for ways that we can be the hands and feet of Jesus to others. We pray, Lord, for the world as it continues to reel and to hurt from COVID-19. I pray, Lord, for mass healings, God. I pray, Lord, for those who are infected to be made well. I pray, Lord, that you will continue to enable the efforts of our healthcare workers, Lord, as they seek and strive so hard and so faithfully to aid their fellow man and woman in their moment of need. I thank you for those who occupy other positions that are essential to the well-being of our society. Thank you for their sense of steadfastness and their commitment as well. Lord, I pray also for our leaders that you will help them to give us good guidance, Lord, to deliberate wisely and in a timely fashion and to help us as a society to find our way forward. We pray, Lord, for positive, effective treatments, a vaccine as well. We pray, Lord, for our economies because our livelihoods are bound up in that. In all things, though, ultimately, our ultimate trust is not in any one person or people or institution or system, God, or government. It is in you. Our trust is in you, and we hope in you. And we know, because you have told us so, that you will not forsake us. You will not let us go. We go from here on that confident note. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, we pray. You are one God, now and forever. And all God's people said, amen. Take care in the meantime. I'll see you Wednesday at 6:30 for prayer meeting. Mm-hmm.